Mr. Sachin Joshi. He completed his bachelor from Sardar Patel College of Engineering and master's from IIT. His professional career spanning 4 decades is in which presented over 40 technical papers and national and international level, most of the related of to management distress in structure. Propagated in concept of FRWD in 1994 in UK, which has been later adopted by many countries for management of structures. Since 2015, has been instrumental in developing and implementing IBMS for MORTH. Passionate about propagated of IBMS at the state and urban level. Presently, he spent most of the time in research of further development of IBMS and its creating an infrastructure framework for its implementation inspire of being in Australia since 2018. Please welcome on stage Mr. Sachin Joshi with a great round of applause. I request Rohan to present him with a token of love from Epicons.
Good morning, all of you, on this wet morning. The talk that today I'm going to give is about IBMS, which has been in use for the last 5 years. And basically, what I intend to do or what I aim to do is to share with all of you what were our learnings and what were our failures. To call it as a failure would be a little bit too harsh, but there were some hiccups and there are some obstacles that we have to overcome. IBMS, to understand more about IBMS, I will be first presenting a short video, and after that, once you know what IBMS is, I will be dwelling on how we went about the entire exercise. IBMS is all about creating an inventory of bridges, and subsequently, once you have an inventory in place, inspecting the bridges to be able to decide which bridge has to be maintained first and what is the procedure for its maintenance. Primarily, the whole process can be automated, like starting from inventory to inspection to testing to repair principles. The entire process can be automated, provided the logic that drives this automated process is acceptable to the owner. So there basically is the cliche. And the birth of any management system, asset management system, initiated with the collapse of a bridge. Way back in, I think, 1964 or something, there was a collapse in US and few people died. I think 34 or 40 people died. And immediately the US government initiated what is now the Bible for any asset management. In that, they identified what are the parameters that should be inventorized, or what the inventory should consist of, what all things, and how they should be linked to the inspection, and subsequently what should be the acceptable limits and what should be the unacceptable limits. All this thing is now computerized. IBMS probably was the first digitized, fully digitized database of bridge management system. Earlier, even in India, Indian Railways have been doing bridge management for over 60 years, and they have been following a manual system. PWDs of various state governments have a bridge register, which has all the information that exists about the bridge. I was surprised when Mr. C.P. Joshi mentioned that they have 111,000 bridges. 5 years ago, when I went to MORTH and asked the same question as to how many bridges are existent on the national network, I couldn't get an answer. And when we started the whole process of IBMS, and subsequently when we completed the inventory for all the states in one cycle, we could then reply to that question, how many bridges exist on the national network? There are 172,000 bridges on the national network, including the culverts. Now, the entire 172,000 plus bridges, including the culverts, were inventorized and inspected. And four cycles have been completed of this inventory and inspection, instead of the six that were envisaged in the three-year period. There were some problems. I think Atul will be dealing or talking about those, how the process got delayed. And subsequently, testing was to happen. We conducted a testing course in our Noida office. Chetan was one of the faculty who came all the way from Mumbai, taught the bridge inspectors as to how testing would be conducted. But we could not move from inspection to testing for whatever reasons. We will dwell about it later. And the whole thing just went in loop. Inventory, inspection, without moving forward. Now, that is one area that I'll be talking, or one topic that I'll be talking later on. I think you can stop the video, because since the audio is not there, there's no point in continuing with the video. What did we find when we were doing these inventories and inspection? We definitely know how many bridges exist on the national network. That was one big positive. And to that extent, the short-term benefit to the ministry was that if someone asked a question as to how many bridges exist on the national network, they can come out with a figure. But did we really achieve the objectives of IBMS? Because if you look at the logo of IBMS, the logo says protecting Indian bridges. Protecting Indian bridges. That was the starting point of IBMS, one of the main principal fundamental objective of IBMS. We were not doing the entire system just to identify the number of bridges or to identify which bridge is in distress or partially distressed or to be closed. The main objective was to protect Indian bridges. And did we achieve that objective at the end of 5 years or 4 years? I would be candid and truthful, and my answer would be no, because even today, Indian bridges on the national network, some of them could be unsafe. I wanted to use the word would collapse, but then it would be alarming. So I would stick to my sentence, parliamentary language, unsafe. And they require urgent attention. It is not that they are unsafe and can be just kept as they are. They require urgent attention. So why did we not move forward? The system was designed, it has the potential. But then, why did we not move forward? Just to give you an example of how severe the distress is, basically this video was prepared for a conference of all the chief engineers of MORTH from various regions. They have close to about 20 regions. Under IBMS, we had 18 packages. And there was one consultant appointed for each of these packages. And he had approximately, the consultant had approximately 7,000 to 10,000 kilometers of road network on which he had to identify the bridges. So there were photographs that were being captured by an automated system with a date stamp on it, date and time stamp on it. So some of the photographs that came to the system were alarming. Few of the examples I have listed out. Each of this can be correlated to the location, to the bridge identity number. So rather than going which bridge, which location, I have just collated some pictures to give you a quick idea about the state of bridges on our national network. Now our national network when we started was 106,000 kilometers. Now it is expanding, probably 180, may go to 250. And if our honorable minister has his say, it could go to 400,000 kilometers. It carries about 80% of the traffic that moves on the Indian roads. Just 2% of the road network carries 80% of the traffic. When I mean traffic, it's basically the haulage that happens across the country. So 80% of haulage happens on the national network. And the state of bridges on the national network is what you see today. There are some very severely distressed bridges which have been either closed or weight restriction or speed restriction has been imposed. But yes, there are defects, there are distress. I wouldn't call them as defects, I would call them as distress. And this distress is arising not out of our abuse. Primarily, if you look at the statistical analysis of IBMS, you would be surprised to know that 65% of our bridges have outlived their life. Why I'm making that statement is because 65% of these bridges are over 50 years old. Some of them are over 100 years old. About 120 or 130 bridges are over 100 years old. If you go to the design codes of those years, 50 years ago or 75 years ago, you would immediately understand why I made the statement that they have outlived their life, because at that moment of time, the design life was only 50 years. And 65% of our bridges have already outlived the life. What was the logic behind protecting the bridges? How was IBMS aiming to achieve its objective of protecting the Indian bridges? The primary logic is based on IRC SP 35, and that says that you do an inventory, you do an inspection. Based on the inspection, you decide, the inspection can be either frequent or routine or detailed, which then generates a maintenance requirement. That maintenance can be again specific maintenance arising out of specific problems, or it could be a frequent maintenance which is required every 6 months or every 3 months, or a routine inspection. There was something, what we call it as a sufficiency and deficiency rating, which the Americans had adopted, which was included in IBMS but was then kept aside or bypassed because Indian codes do not support that system of sufficiency and deficiency ratings. So what we did was use the rating to then define whether the bridges would go for inspection, immediate inspection, or testing or closure. So primarily the closure decision comes out of the initial inspection, because you can't take a risk of allowing the bridge to be operational if the bridge is seen to have severe distress. And then is the management of bridge, and under management you have a whole lot of modules, starting from how the bridge deteriorates, when will the bridge deteriorate, how will the bridge deteriorate, that is the deterioration module. Then you have the ranking and priority module, which defines which bridge you should take initially for inspection. In India, we face a peculiar problem. We don't deal with things only technically. There is something as a socio-economic pressure that is created on the engineers to deal with the situation. So if the minister stands up in the parliament and is answering to one question, there will be a member coming from a particular constituency, and he would contradict what the minister is saying by photographs or by statements showing that this is a bridge in my constituency and it is in dire condition, and so many people are crossing it. There is a village that is this thing, and if that member happens to be from the ruling party, then the minister has to take care of that constituency. The funds get diverted to that bridge. These type of problems are faced by the government officers every day. It's not that only a technical logic can define or govern the type of input or intervention that the government officer can do. So we have within IBMS what is known as a socio-economic parameter. And these socio-economic parameters capture the various social or economic parameters that can affect the bridge. Like, does the bridge connect to important cities? If the bridge connect to important cities, obviously it is an important, it is a bridge on an important link. How many vehicles, how many people either move from one end of the bridge to the other, or how many trucks move from one end of the bridge to the other? So that decides what is the average vehicle movement on the bridge. Then, does this bridge inspire or create an economic development in the other area? Because, for example, Thane Creek Bridge, which Mr. Joshi mentioned, created a link for Mumbai with a then very small town called Navi Mumbai, which was being created. But today, within 30 years, we have seen that the number of vehicles that cross Thane Creek Bridge is increasing so much, many folds, that three parallel bridges exist, and even today they have a traffic jam. So I can give you one example from Australia, Sydney, where the bridge was constructed, the famous bridge, Harbour Bridge, which is a steel bridge, was constructed to connect the downtown Sydney to a North Shore area where the population was about 600 and odd. But the bridge was constructed. And today, North Shore has become a parallel central business district as much as the Sydney main town is. Same thing what is happening between Mumbai and Navi Mumbai. So that type of economic growth is possible when you connect to non-reachable areas. So those parameters are already embedded in IBMS under the socio-economic parameters, which help in the management, which help in the ranking and prioritization of bridges. Coming to the inventory data, mind you, the entire system had to be designed within the available gambit of the coal provisions, because the person on the field, the last man who attends to the bridges, can only operate if there is a codal provision available for his action. Otherwise, his actions will be deemed outside the code or outside the acceptable norm. So the entire system had to be designed within the codal provision, and the codal provisions were in a very rudimentary or very basic level. However, IRC SP35, the inventory data that was captured was as per that. The inspection was again as per IRC SP35. Condition and inventory rating was something which IBMS introduced, which was not present under the IRC SP35. Now the revised code that is coming out has ratings included. There is a new code that is being presently deliberated and will be available probably early next year. What we said was, there is still a debate going on whether the rating should be in 5 numbers or in 10 numbers. Our intention of using 10 numbers was, we do not have trained manpower to distinguish critically an entire bridge structure in 5 numbers. Even distinguishing it in 10 numbers is sometimes difficult, because bridge is multi-span. It's a huge structure. You have many components. You have many spans. Each span has multiple components. You have 5 girders, you have 7 girders, you have cross beams, you have piers, you have abutments, whole lot of things are there. And to look at the structure as a whole and give one structural rating, and if it is in 5, someone might see at one corner of the bridge, which I am able to see, and say, oh, there's so much distress in this corner, I will give the rating as 2. whereas the entire bridge is good and only 10% of the area is bad. Should I give the rating 2 or should I give the rating 3 or should I give the rating 5? It's something which is a grey area because there is no codal provision available. To avoid this confusion, we said that each of this 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, we will expand it. 0 will be 0 and 1, 1 will be 2 and 3. So similarly, we expanded the definitions to fit into 0 to 9. So IBMS follows a rating, this thing of 0 to 9. 0 rating is the worst case scenario where the bridge is closed. 1 and 2 is bridges which will require immediate attention. And then even if it is 10% but critical, even a 10% area if it is in distress and it can collapse, the bridge can be severed. There can be a cut. One span collapses, the bridge is of no use. So all those conditions will come under rating 1 and 2, which require immediate attention. And then you have rating 3, 4 and 5, where a planned inspection can be possible. Because if all of you are aware of how things move, once you submit a DPR or a project proposal for rehabilitation of any bridge, it has to go the whole government machinery before it can be tendered and actual repair can start. So from conceptualization of repair to actual repair, the fastest it can move is about 3 months or 6 months, but ideal time is anywhere between 1 year to 2 years. So one has to be very careful when you say that planned inspection, you have to account for that delay. When you say that the bridge can be repaired in 2 years, and if someone starts preparing a DPR after 2 years and the action is going to happen after 4 years, your initial judgment that bridge needs intervention after 2 years is lost. And the bridge can come suddenly into an immediate action required, where within 2 months you either have to start the repair or you have to close the bridge. So this distinction or this classification plays a very critical role in the entire management of the bridges. 6, 7, 8, we have termed it as safe zone. 9 rating is only allotted to bridges which are new within 1 year. Even if the bridge is in very good condition and it is more than 1 year, you cannot give a rating of 9. You need to move to the rating of 8 because of the age. Based on this, then you have to identify what is the cause that is causing the distress. Unless the cause is identified, you can't decide what action you can take. The remedy cannot be decided if the cause is not identified. And to identify the cause, we did not have any codal provision. So what we did was, we relied on EN 1504. They have identified, and mind you, when I'm deliberating today, I'm deliberating only about concrete structures, because 84% of our bridges are concrete, pure concrete structures or masonry and concrete. There is a small fraction which is concrete and steel, and a very small fraction, probably in decimals, which is only steel bridges. So generally when we are talking about, and when we are discussing this, keep that in mind that we are only talking about concrete bridges. So when we are talking about concrete bridges, EN 1504 identifies the causes in 3 principal areas: mechanical, physical and chemical. And based on that, the testing is decided. Because it is like, very Chetan I think would be dealing on that in detail. If you have blood sugar, you don't need to have a chest x-ray. You need to do a blood test which identifies sugar in your body. So primarily, the testing has to be taken up only for the cause which is causing the distress and not a general testing to identify the distress. So based on the conditions, cause rating, we then come to what is known as a matrix, because the bridge, as I mentioned, is a massive structure. There could be multiple causes. Unlike a human body, Even in human body, you have multiple reasons why you fall sick. But in bridges or in any concrete structure, it is definitely so. There could be primary causes and there could be secondary causes. The primary cause could be chemical, but the secondary cause could be mechanical or physical. But all those causes will have to be attended when you are attending to the intervention or when you intend to give the intervention. So all those causes form what is known as the cause matrix, and based on the cause rating, we can then classify the type of repairs that will be undertaken, whether it is a major repair or a minor repair or bridge closure. The whole management cycle can happen only if we go beyond inventory and inspection. And that was one of the shortcomings of implementing IBMS. We never could go beyond inspection and inventory. Why did we not venture beyond? Was there something which did not allow us to do that? Or was it that we were only interested in inventory and inspection? Were we moving in circles, like a blind man? You tell him to go in a straight line, invariably he goes in round, round and round fashion. Was IBMS doing that? One of the main reasons why we could not go in the straight direction was lack of codal provisions. Directives and guidelines were not available. So having identified that as one of the reasons, we got IRC into action, and IRC SP 35, IRC SP 40, and all related codes related to bridge maintenance, management, and repairs were to be revamped to include the backing that the management system would require, because IBMS was a pilot project. It was the first of its kind in India. States were to follow this implementation. And tomorrow even the states will face the same problem, and they would also start going round and round without achieving the objective. And we are spending a lot of money on this. It is not that things are being done free of cost. So the government is spending a lot of money. So guidelines and directives are under preparation. It is work in progress. It will take some time. Testing generally in India is done to identify a cause. However, I think Chetan agrees on that point, that we should do the testing to confirm a cause, not to identify the cause. Identification of the cause has to come from here, and that is where the human intelligence comes into play. Unless you have a good bridge engineer going to the bridge, understanding the structure, feeling the structure, resonance, how it behaves when a truck moves, what are the vibrations, what are the immediate response of the structure to the purpose why it is intended. Unless a human being goes and sees it himself, all further things are useless. So the testing has to follow or confirm the prognosis that the engineer creates. And the testing can either confirm the prognosis or reject it. If the testing rejects it, then it goes back to the basic, again do the prognosis. Because as engineers, we want some value, and prognosis is qualitative. It is my thought or my judgment against your judgment. And when three engineers go to the site, maybe from the same company or maybe from the same consultancy, all three engineers will have a different feel about the bridge. Then how do we conclude? Okay, then there's a team leader who comes into the picture and says, no, this is what is the reason. Let us write that as the reason for distress. Having made that prognosis, the testing should be able to give you a qualitative value. Because as engineers, we believe in numbers. We don't believe in qualitative statements. All our engineering is dependent on formulas or on numbers. So we need solid numbers, testing. He gives you a figure within permissible range, outside permissible range. Oh, I am confident. Because it is within permissible range, I can go ahead and accept that structure. Then, having confirmed the prognosis, then will come the remedial measures. And when we came to the remedial measures, we searched the entire library of books available or data available within MORTH, within IRC or state PWDs, and we could identify 10 to 12 specifications that existed. You could enumerate 30, but if you look at those specifications closely, they fall under only 10 to 12 specifications. Are those 10 to 12 specifications sufficient for us to address the entire gambit of rehabilitation of bridges? You will answer that question at the end of my talk. So what are the viewpoints? This is my topic. Whatever I talk now was a preamble. Sorry. Viewpoints of IBMS towards repairs and rehabilitation. I'm going back to the flowchart. As I said, coming to the last this thing, the mechanical, physical and chemical causes or drivers for distress, and then the related test, and then the related remedial measures, and then the principles involved in the remedial measures. Confirmation of rating is a very critical aspect of the entire process. One thing that we learned out of the initial implementation was that we did not have an internal quality check within IBMS system. Anything that you do needs to have a quality check. If a person, which could be a junior engineer, is doing some work, some senior has to either approve, reject or change whatever he has done. So we inbuilt a mechanism where confirmation of rating will happen, and that's the advanced version of IBMS that we are now using, wherein the ratings given in the inventory, because the inventory was supposed to be done by a junior engineer, inspection was supposed to be done by a bridge engineer. Inspection, at inspection, the prognosis has to be confirmed. So it was prudent or it was logical that the bridge engineer looks at the rating given by the junior engineer and then either confirms the rating or modifies it. And those modified ratings are then used by the system for the entire management. So confirmation, based on those ratings, which are socioeconomic, structural, and environmental, all those ratings, there are about 12 parameters for which ratings are generated. Based on those ratings, you can either say we need to have a planned inspection or immediate attention or closure of bridge. It doesn't say anything about repairs or testing or anything. It just gives you a basic idea what you need to do, whether you need to have a closer look at the bridge or that bridge can be taken safely into the safe zone. The second step, that is a trained and experienced bridge engineer identifies the defects based on the extent, type, severity, and generates a prognosis of the cause of the defect. To make it simple, we have adopted EN 1504, which is already an accepted document in Europe. So in the absence of any concrete document in India, we adopted EN 1504. And what does EN 1504 says? That you have the primary causes of deterioration in concrete can be either mechanical, physical or chemical. Under mechanical, EN 1504 has only four sub-thing: impact, abrasion, erosion and overload. Fatigue is an addition that we have put in because two reasons. One, our bridges are being used beyond their service life, designed service life, and over the last 7 or 8 years, our loadings have multiplied to maybe 3 times or 4 times the design load. So fatigue is a critical aspect that needs to be evaluated. Under physical, it's temperature, shrinkage, and in the chemical, you have carbon dioxide, chloride, sulfates, carbonation, alkali aggregate reaction. So these 11 things are primary causes that can lead to distress. Once you have these causes, then you have to link these causes to the tests. How many test specifications or codes do we have in India? 4. Correct me if I'm wrong. There are only 4 test codes available in India. UPV, RHT, carbonation, and coring. So you can't correlate these 4 tests to all the 11 causes. So we needed some more tests. We have now incorporated 24 tests in IRC SP40. And to some extent, this table exactly doesn't exist in IRC SP40, but the new IRC SP40. But what we have done is, we have identified the parameters which these tests can easily conclude. So, for example, pullout, penetration, there are a whole host of them. Most of the tests, I think, will be covered by Chetan, so I will not spend time on this. Oh, you're not talking on NDT?
I think someone else is covering.
Okay. So there is someone covering NDT. Fine. So there are now 24 tests, and most of, if you look at, none of the parameters are missed out. A1 to A5 are covered here. P1, physical P1 and P2 are covered, and chemical C1, C2, C3, C4 are covered. So all the parameters can be identified or confirmed by the 24 tests that we have. I'm not too sure whether there is any agency who can do all the 24 tests, but definitely we have agencies who can do a few of them, and all over India there these tests are being performed. However, still there are new technologies available. But because there are no relevant codes available anywhere, we cannot adopt those new technologies even today. Like drone technology is being used in all areas of life, including now to transfer medicine, to transfer human body parts from one place to another. Medical fraternity has embraced drones. Survey teams have embraced drones and accepted. Satellite imaging is being accepted. But these same technologies, the rehabilitation industry or the construction industry is yet shying to embrace. The reasons, I don't know. So many things can be made simple, but we cannot use them. Repairs. What do we do when it comes to repairing a structure? Based on the cause of distress rating, test results, proper remedial measures will have to be adopted. However, bridge structure is massive, as I said. Primary and secondary causes have to be identified. Then we come to what is known as a cause matrix, which identifies the primary causes and the secondary causes. So each of those 11 parameters get a rating. And this 11 parameter, along with the ratings, form the matrix. Certain principles of repair can only be identified for every cause. You can't take a medicine which is for acidity when you are having or suffering from cold, or vice versa. You need to have a specific medicine for a specific cause. The same thing needs to be adopted in our repair industry. You can't have one medicine as applicable only for all the causes. No. No such medicine is available. So there are 12 primary principles that can be adopted for repairs and rehabilitation. My colleague, Mr. Sagi, is going to dwell in detail on those 12 principles and various methodologies available under that principle. But to maintain a continuity, I'll just briefly go through it. Each of these methods need proper specification. Now, as I said initially, we have 10 to 12 specifications, broad specifications presently available. And there are 12 principles. Unless you have a specification, the last man on the field will not implement those because he will always have a fear of implementing something which is not backed by a proper specification or methodology. The procedure as given by the consultant alone is not sufficient. The procedure has to be backed by a code of practice or a standard procedure, or it should be in the pink book of Moth. Otherwise, the fear psychosis is always there. We do not have specification and procedures. In the first year of our operation, we initiated a process in which we had identified some 60 odd specifications that were required. We started compiling those, but realized that unless it goes through IRC, it cannot be adopted. So again, we went to IRC. What are the principles? The 12 principles are protection against ingress, moisture control, concrete restoration, structural strengthening, and there are 12 such principles. And these principles are correlated to the causes. I think you are going to deal with that, right? So the next topic will deal with that. Another main factor that is inhibiting our implementation or extracting the potential of the system is lack of institutional framework, which can create the required documents, which can create a required protocol. See, bridge engineers are being trained in-house by various consultants. We conducted a primary training program when we started IBMS, but that training was not institutionalized. Those engineers, the ground person, junior engineers with 3 years experience, 4 years experience, may have inspected or inventorized thousands of bridges in that 3 years period. Howsoever, his experience is not institutionalized. His experience is only with him. It is not recognized anywhere. So tomorrow when he has to go and work somewhere, unless the consultant identifies and certifies ki yes, he was an engineer working with us on this project and has inspected so many bridges, he cannot vouch for his experience. However, if you have a framework which trains the person and then accredits the person, and that accreditation process is incremental on year-to-year basis based on what work he has done during that year. Has he used his training and accreditation to inspect, inventorize, or design the repair method or supervise the repair system? It doesn't get included within the system. So next time when you come and bid for the work, again you are starting from zero. So institutional framework is a very important backbone that is required to implement this system. Software, field inventory, inspections cannot manage the bridges. You need to go beyond that and you need to have this framework. India has a large number of distress bridges. It is not that we don't have distress bridges. We have a large number of distress bridges and a large number of beyond service life utilization of bridges. Not all bridges can be rectified in one fiscal because budgets are limited. The budget is not like a rubber band. You can't stretch it beyond a certain limit. So what do we do? IBMS adopted the principle of FRWD, first repair the worst defect. That principle, in fact, originated when I made the presentation based on my study of housing societies in Mumbai, in Edinburgh University. And that then got propelled and used in most of the rehabilitation works that are being done across the world. And this principle was based on limited budget, because even if you go to a housing society, they have very limited budget, 10,000 per member, 12,000 per member, and that's the end of it. So how do we do the work? So you identify the worst defect and repair that. The principle is you progressively move. If you look at the management of bridges now, and if you apply this principle, what happens is all those bridges, I know, I've got 2 minutes. 5 minutes. Oh, bonus of 3 minutes. Thank you. One eye is here, don't worry. When you're repairing the bridges, as you know, any rating which is above 6 is considered as safe. But does it mean that there are no distress on those bridges which rating 6? There are distress. But those can wait. Those can be tackled at a later date. So our intention was to first bring all those bridges which are in 0 to maybe 1 or 2, those bridges which are in 1 or 2 to 3, 4, 5, and those bridges which are in 3, 4, 5 to above 6. So progressively, maybe in a couple of years or maybe in a couple of cycles, most of the bridges would go to the safe zone. Then what? Then how do we manage? Once all the bridges are in the safe zone, then we attend to the first defect, we attend to the defect at the first sign. Whenever you see a smallest defect, you then can probably attend to those defects also. And that is the final culmination or fulfillment of IBM's objective. To reach that, it may take 20 years. I'm not promising anything in 2 years or 3 years. It's a long haul. It is not, there's no shortcut. Cycles will have to be repeated. Repeated inventories will have to be done. Inspections will have to be done. Data will have to be generated, because subsequent to this comes the deterioration models. How and when will my bridge deteriorate? Once we have everything in safe zone, then my interest would be, I have got a certain budget. What do I use the budget for? Okay, I have got this set of bridges which are likely to deteriorate starting from 3rd year from now. So can I do some exercise on those bridges and see whether I can avoid that scenario or whether I can do that? That is really taking IBMS or extracting the maximum out of the whole system. Unless you reach that level, efficiency of the system shall not be achieved. Few steps that we feel are essential: train manpower. Training is to generate the rating and cost, because those are the starting points for any management system. Analytical training to define the prognosis, because unless the prognosis is correctly made, you can't go for testing. Then the testing also needs some training, and framework to support R&R activity, guidelines for the entire flow of activity for the management of bridges. I think I'm 2 minutes early, so I can take one or two questions.